Good morning, Church of the Palms. Ooh, my friends, what a bright, shiny day to come to church. Yes, we have lots of church life activities that we want to share, so we're going to get right to it. Our flowers today are from a memorial service yesterday. Thank you to Jeffrey Scruggs for rearranging the flowers so that we might be able to enjoy their beauty today. The memorial service yesterday was for our pastor emeritus, Reverend Clint Reynolds. Clint was an amazing human. When Martin Luther King Jr. made the call for white clergy to come down to Selma, Clint went and marched with King, responding to the call that God makes on all of us. He was faithful. All who knew him were blessed. We've got lots of other information I wanted to share. We have an information session coming up. If you are interested in becoming a church member, we have an information session coming up. The information is on that inside page, page 2 of your worship packet. It's a chance to learn more about the church, to ask questions you always wanted to know, to get to know our leadership, get a meal to eat as well. Contact Iona Schultz and let her know if you are interested in participating in that. Our 2023 donation statements were sent out electronically on January 16th. Please check your email for that statement. It may have gone to the spam folder. You'll need to check that. If you do not have an email address, if we do not have an email address for you, they were sent in regular mail. Any and all questions go to Bertie Fitch. Where are you, Bertie? Where are you? I can't see you. You're somewhere. I'd say stand up, but, you know, she's short. So she's out in the narthex. Yes, it's tough. Yeah. A reminder, if you are interested in hearing my jokes over and over again, you can. You can on our Sunday online videos. There's information in our bulletin as well to access our weekly calendar online. You can attend a class via Zoom. Your bulletin has instructions for all of that. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel and stay updated. Next week, you're going to want to bring your cash to church because there will be Girl Scout cookies to eat next week. So, yeah, if you have to sell a kidney, get some cash somehow, some way, and be generous. And, you know, pastors like gifts. Yes, we do. Thin mints because we're so thin, right? We're wasting away. We are in a Super Bowl competition trying to crush our opponent with love. Raise a lot of food for the food bank to feed hungry folks. Yeah, that's it. We laugh, we have fun with this, but it's serious. Hunger is a serious issue, and we can help out and have fun on the way. Bring soup with you every worship service. We're going to keep bringing it until the Super Bowl Sunday, until that game is over. We are the defending champion. Now it's time to repeat and keep the coveted silver ladle where it belongs. Let's see. The last thing I have on my calendar is the annual meeting. Woohoo! So much excitement. Let me tell you, this Saturday, January 27th, 9 a.m. on Saturday in this very room. It's part meeting, part worship. You get a chance to vote on our officers and our boards. You get the chance to vote on our 2024 budget. You get to hear my State of the Church address and learn of the upcoming themes and focus. Plus, there's a question and answer time where you can ask those questions you always wanted to ask. I hope you can attend this Saturday, January 27th, 9 a.m. All right, Pastor Jim, is it safe to invite you up here with a box of Girl Scout cookies?
Well, let's just see. I was hoping you'd have them unwrapped already, but all right. Thanks. Good morning, Church of the Palms. We are a part of the United Church of Christ. You have met Pastor Paul. I am Pastor Jim still. And we are glad that you have chosen to worship here in this safe space where all are welcome. In your joy and in your sorrow. In your confidence and in your fear. God is here to meet you. In your strength and in your weaknesses, God is here to meet you. In your sexuality, your mental and spiritual capacity, God is here to meet you. How, you may ask? Through the unconditional love of all the people around you in this room. Come and meet God, who loves you and created you just as you were intended to be. With Martin Meadows, with Jen, with our choir, and with you, let us worship God.
Good morning. Please join me in a responsive call to worship. For just this hour,
follow me.
Listen to my word.
Follow me.
Think about your life as my disciple every day.
Follow me.
Pray.
Follow me.
Sing.
Follow me.
Come, let us worship God.
Here we go. And
I've got a feeling everything is gonna be all right. Oh, I've got a feeling everything is gonna be all right. Oh, I've got a feeling everything is gonna be all right. Be all right, be all right, be all right. Jesus already told me everything is gonna be all right. Oh, Jesus already told me everything is gonna be all right. Oh, Jesus already told me everything is gonna be all right. Be all right, be all right, be all right. The Spirit has confirmed it. Everything is gonna be all right. Oh, the Spirit has confirmed it. Everything is gonna be all right. Oh, the Spirit has confirmed it. Everything is gonna be all right. Be all right. Be all right. Be
singing. You may be seated.
In our spiritual readings segment of worship, we offer a variety of quotes from the famous and not so famous writers, poets, singers, actors, thinkers, and theologians as we ponder the spiritual meaning of following Jesus and fishing. Harry Middleton offers deeper insight into the idea of fishing for humankind. He was an American writer and the author of 5 fishing and outdoor lifestyle books. He said, "Fishing is not an escape from life, but often a deeper immersion into it." Martha Hall Kelly, American novelist and best-selling author of Lilac Girls, a best-selling novel based on the true story of 72 Polish women who were imprisoned and experimented on at Ravensbrück concentration camp in Germany, she observed, "How easy is it to get tangled up in your own fishing net?" Israel Moore Aviara, youth leadership coach, author, and inspirational speaker, as well as a life skills entrepreneur, offers, "If you are trying to look clean, neat, and avoid casting your nets in troubled waters, you will catch no fish."
Yeah.
Our scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 14 through 20. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boats mending the nets. Immediately he called to them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
In my early years as a new Christian, I would hear sermons preached on this passage. It seemed like more often than not, the preachers would linger on this idea of the train's just around the bend. Get ready. The kingdom of God is at hand. Your problems will be no more. No more war, no more poverty. Hallelujah. It's time. You better get ready. But you gotta leave your worldly ways. Follow the straight and narrow. Get committed to church. And P.S. Here's some rules for clean living, just so you don't get left behind. And while there's much to be said for getting involved in the church and turning away from the ways of the world, where is the connection between the kind of world we are preparing for, a world without divisions or class or money, where the earth is pure, unpolluted, where all are healthy, there's no more sickness, where all the hunger is gone? Where's the connection between that world and the one in which we currently live? Wouldn't getting ready for God's kingdom come, where these horrors are done away with, mean plugging in to the world, into this world, actively addressing the causes of poverty or pollution or tearing down barriers built by race or religion? Yeah, it seems like some of the messages I heard back then focused on fishing for people in order to grow the church numerically, financially. Far less time was spent on focusing on nurturing people spiritually. But the Spirit has not come for some time in the distant future, but for the right here and the right now. And I believe that God is calling us to heal the sick, open blind eyes, work for justice. There are places throughout the Gospel of Mark showing Jesus not just proclaiming a new day would be dawning, but initiating it in real time, modeling a life of seeking out what is broken in the world and offering a new way. Jesus taught the ways to mend the world in which we live by choosing to embrace peacemaking rather than violence, by choosing to tear down barriers of division, by affirming God's handiwork in each person, by feeding the poor and the hungry, clothing the naked. We are called to action. Not to wait for someone else to set the world right, but God is calling us to imagine what we could be if we followed the divine hook, line, and sinker. Will you pray with me? Holy God, we are grateful for these moments that we have together to worship you, to sing, to pray, to hear a word from you. So block out the words that come from my mouth and make clear the words that come from your Spirit. We pray these things in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Fourth century doctor of the church, St. Augustine of Hippo. I want a name like Hippo. Was a bishop and a theologian who had and continues to have tremendous impact on Christianity, both Catholics and Protestants. And he asked questions like, what does love look like? It has hands to help others. It has feet to hasten to the poor and needy. It has eyes to see the misery and want. It has ears to hear the sighs and sorrows of humankind. That's what love looks like. He offered insight like, a Christian is a mind through which Christ thinks, a heart through which Christ loves, a voice through which Christ speaks, and a hand through which Christ helps. Augustine also realized and recognized the truth about our humanness. There is no saint without a past. There is no sinner without a future. And finally, St. Augustine was an encourager to the fish and to the fishers. If God seems slow in responding, it is because God is preparing a better gift. God will not deny us. God withholds what you are not ready for. God wants you to have a lively desire for the greatest gifts. All of which is to say, pray always. And don't lose heart. Follow me is Jesus' invitation to a new way of being in the world. These four fishermen accepted an invitation to follow. Their lives were forever different. They would no longer catch fish. They would fish for people. And when Jesus said to them, I will make you fish for people, he was describing a complete transformation of life, not simply a job of catching new members or followers. He could have easily said to the carpenters, follow me, you'll build a kingdom of heaven. To farmers, follow me, and you will grow God's people. To the doctors, follow me and you will heal the brokenness in the world. To teachers, follow me and you will open minds and hearts to the presence of God. To parents, follow me and you will nurture new life. To the members of the Church of the Palms, follow me and you will give voice to the voiceless. Give food and shelter to the unhoused. Work for justice and dignity of all peoples. Whatever our lives are, however we spend our time, Jesus is calling us to follow. Follow me is the call to participate with God in God's saving work. It is the work of change and growth. And that work is always about moving into a larger vision, orienting our lives to new direction. And in so doing, we invite others, we encourage others, we walk with others along the way. That's the kind of fishing we're talking about today. So now if Mark were writing about me, when he gets to the part where Jesus says, follow me, Mark would write, and so comes the questions. Where are we going? What are we going to do? How long are we going to be gone? Are we there yet? What do I need to take? Where are we going to stay? But notice Jesus offers an invitation, not a map, not an itinerary, doesn't even mention destination, only an invitation. This is not the type of journey you can prepare for. It's an inner journey, a journey into the deepest parts of our being, the place where God resides. It's not about planning and organizing, making lists, packing supplies. It's about the real work of becoming who God is calling us to be. If anything, this journey is about what are we going to leave behind? The Gospel of Mark says, immediately, poof, they left their nets and they just followed. They left even their father Zebedee. That's another cool name. In the boat. See ya. The invitation, follow me, is an invitation to leave behind our nets, our boats, our family members. That's the hard part for most of us. We're pretty good at holding tight to what we know, what's tried and true. And even the people and the things that may not be the very best for us. More often than not, our spiritual growth involves some kind of letting go. We never get anywhere as long as we are unwilling to leave where we are. We accept Jesus' invitation to follow, not by packing up, but by letting go. Follow me is both an invitation to and the promise of new life. The promise is where faith and trust come in. As I suggested a few weeks ago, it's about showing up for ourselves and trusting God's promises. And it takes as long as it takes. So what are the nets that entangle us? What are the little boats that contain our lives? Is your little boat watertight? Or is yours like mine, a little leaky? Who are the people or addictions from whence we seek identity? Or value, or approval? What do we need to let go and leave behind to follow Jesus? Another way that we can look at this story, according to Mark, upon hearing that John the Baptist had been arrested by the forces of the empire, Jesus of Nazareth appeared in Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. Jesus said, "This time is the time of fulfillment. The reign of God is at hand. Change your hearts and minds and believe in the good news. Abandon your nets. Become fishers of humankind." And no sooner does Jesus get the words out of his mouth, and the fishers just follow. What could have possessed them to drop everything and follow Jesus? Is there more to the story than fishing for new members, new converts, new conversation partners? A part of the story I had never really thought about or really even known was that Jesus may not have been leading these fishers on a quest to save souls or convert or make believers or any of that. The phrase fishing for men already had a long history for the Jewish people. Biblical historian Ched Meyer suggests that we look back at Hebrew scripture and we will see the phrase that was used by the Jewish prophets like Jeremiah and Amos and Ezekiel. Jesus didn't just happen upon four fishermen. Jesus, upon hearing the arrest by the forces of the empire of John the Baptist, went down to the Sea of Galilee precisely because the Sea of Galilee was in the throes of Roman oppression. Simon, Andrew, James, John were a part of a fishing enterprise which was being squeezed by the tax man. Rome had placed an exorbitant tax upon every fish that was caught in the Sea of Galilee. This once prosperous fishing spot was the target of the empire's quest for treasure. The injustice of oppression was felt acutely among the people who made their homes on the shores of Galilee. The forces of Rome exacted a high price from those who did not or could not pay their tribute. Fishers were being forced into servitude, or worse yet, into slavery. So it's not surprising that Jesus hearkened back to the prophets of old who used the metaphor to catch a fish as a euphemism for exacting judgment upon the rich. By inviting these oppressed fishers to fish for men, Jesus was inviting the persecuted to join him in his struggle to overturn the existing order of power and privilege. Jesus went on to insist that the reign of God is at hand. In the Greek, the basileia ton theon, the empire of the divine mystery, who Jesus insists is love. The reign of love is at hand. Jesus didn't invite the persecuted to follow him to fish for souls or converts or believers. Jesus invited the persecuted to follow him and learn how to usher in the reign of love, a kingdom. In the words of John Dominic Cross, a place where everyone has enough. Following Jesus is about learning the Jesus way of overturning the existing order of wealth or power or privilege. Jesus' call to follow is as radical as dropping everything to usher in the reign of love, creating the kind of kingdom where everyone has enough by doing it the Jesus way of nonviolent resistance. Can we find the courage to leave behind our nets, our leaky boat, the things that we hold so tightly, and respond hook, line, and sinker to Jesus' call to follow a way which ushers in the reign of love? It's right here. It is right now. It is for you and for me. Amen.
We don't have a litany of do yous at this church. Do you believe this? Do you believe that? Etc. We don't have a lot of surelys either. Well, surely you believe this and surely you believe that. There's no litmus test to see if you get a passing grade or measure up. You don't have to get your fishing license to cast your nets. We simply ask, do you agree to follow? We believe that we're going to figure out the rest on the journey with God's blessing. God calls you and me to do great and small things all the time. And usually we do what we were going to do anyway. We're not what we should be. But the good news of God is that anyone in Christ becomes a new person altogether. The past is finished and gone. Everything has become fresh and new. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and empowered to serve. With that context, let us go to God together in prayer. Oh God, you are our rock, our strength. We come lifting our heart's desires for this world, and we pray for peace. Oh, love, there are many in this very room who are crying out to you, even though they appear silent to those around you. Hear our cries. See through our phoniness. Give relief to our pain. Give us the courage and the strength. Give us the tools necessary for us not only to survive, but to come alive and make the choices you intend for us. Holy One, you called Jonah. You called men, you called women throughout Scripture. Call us to. Bless us with the openness to hear you. Bless us with the wisdom to acknowledge you. Bless us with the grace to follow you in all the ways we are called. Help us to let go of that to which we cling so closely. Bless us in our confidence and in our disbelief. Bless us in our triumphs and in our defeats. Bless us with the opportunity to give all that we have, all that we are, all that we may become. And help us to follow wherever we are on this journey of life. To follow your love. This we ask in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not.
As you know, at least once a month, we try to, as our volunteer engagement committee, to recognize a board and a team who are doing great and amazing ministry around this church and around our community. And so today would be no different. It's our opportunity to recognize and show appreciation to the mission and outreach team. So if you are a part of the mission and outreach team, I would like for you to come forward. Don't make me call you by name.
We want to say thank you for all the ways you encourage us to be the church. I love going to mission and outreach meetings because we get to hand out blessings to other charities in this community. It is such a joy to be there. So thank you for representing our faith community by seeking out and making a difference in organizations like Asylum Seekers, Dice Art Community Center, The Heart Pantry, New Life Shelter, Sun City Posse, Tent of Nations, Deep Within, Outreach to Enrich in South Africa, and all the other UCC ministries, and so many, many more. We are grateful, John Durbin, Jen Eckstein, Eric Holmes, Suzanne Beauclair, Linda Hoffman, Judy Sadler, Ann Plaziak is up there.
Is yes. Way back there.
I don't have
Come on down.
And Larry Cornelius. Got you. All right. And there you go. Thank
you. Everyone said?
Amen.
Well, they're not the only group we're recognizing, is it?
No.
No, no, no. Some people who are very close to my heart because they take care and are good stewards of our property and our buildings, and we just celebrate their ministry, and so I'm going to hand that to you.
If you are a member of the Board of Trustees or have ever picked up a hammer before, come on down. We are grateful for your prayerful and active support in carrying out the mission of the Church of the Palms by maintaining our sacred spaces on campus. And in this way, we are able to offer unconditional love, justice, and a safe, extravagant welcome.
That's right.
Ron Keel, Chuck Eckstein, who is not with us today, Larry Cornelius, we made you go walk all the way back there. Mary will bring it to you. She's a servant that way. Frank Bocknecht. Michael Balch is not with us today. And Mary Hoy. And God's people said,
Amen.
Thank you so much. As we come to our offertory time together, fishing bestows blessings, but it requires offerings, whether it be the cost of bait or fuel or equipment or investment of brain power, sweat, and precious gifts of hope and time. Doing ministry together bestows blessings, but requires offerings too. Whether it's the cost of time or talent or treasure, and oh yes, there's still that brain power and sweat and the precious gifts of hope and faith and trust and love. Some of the fruits of our ministry together will immediately be evident, while others will take time. Ministry and the fruits thereof that we will never realize in our lifetime. But let us be in a moment of generous giving of our whole selves. Ushers, will you wait on us? Thank you.
generous God.
Make us generous in your image. Make us compassionate in your image. Make us faithful in your image. Bless these gifts and all the gifts we offer, that your kingdom may come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Well, we've come to the end of this service. I don't know what we're serving. I think we're out of whipped cream finally. So I'm not sure what's back there, but I do know for sure that there is love and there is conversation. There's an opportunity for each of us to get to know each other just a little bit better. So we're going to stand together as we have a responsive benediction. We're going to sing, and then we're going to go to fellowship. As you go out into the world,
follow me.
At home with your household,
follow me.
At work or at rest,
follow me.
In everything you do this week,
follow me.
And as you do, remember that I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen?
Amen.
Let's sing.